end of the line. When it comes to 18 tracks, the girls, the really cycle for singing, the onset, the suspension, and the release. Thank you. So the history exercise I use for the description of onset, suspension, and release. So I'm going to ask the girls now to breathe into their sides. Prescriptions for Choral Excellence is an excellent resource tool, which Thomas Julian has talked about the appoggio and the idea of breathing into the sides. Because if you breathe into your friends, you automatically make the parts in the back. Okay. So, on your body, we always encourage the women to put their hands somewhere. We like the aesthetic gesture very much. So I want you to sense down as they release the first onset of the hips and stretch their sides.
Yeah.
Yahi. And what that does, again, it sort of pulls us down back and sort of cuts off the airflow. And again, we lose the presence and the brilliance of the Italian off. And we always shake a lot of things into the Italian off spot because of the high placement of that. So we're going to try to really try this again. Again, try to get the introduction of something that helps to turn everybody get into their high stakes with that Italian off spot. Let's see if we can do it.
Thank you.
All right. Better?
Yes. Yes.
I would like that.
think that it allowed them to free up the mechanism and not feel like they're constantly holding back and holding things in place that way. So that's just two different ways to approach balance in the section. Choosing literature for your women's choir. What better place to start than exposing your choir to historical women composers? Hildegard of Bingen was a 12th century visionary theologian, in addition to being a composer of religious songs and a lengthy music drama, unprecedented in the time. She founded her own community of nuns in St. Rupertsburg. Of course, it was against the wishes of the monks at the time. She's often called a mystic. She wrote about her visions on medicine and science, as well as the lives of the saints. In O Frommen's Virga, the antiphon that you heard as we processed, that's a piece that's connected with the nuns at St. Rupertsburg, and here they sing seven different prayer services each day, plus daily mass. Their day began at 2 a.m. with matins, and ended after sunset with compline. From Karen Pendle's book, Women in Music, she said, Hildegard's awareness of herself as a woman among women seems evident in the text of her songs. Many of her 77 existing chants honor women, such as the Virgin Marys and female saints. Working within a women's community, Hildegard develops remarkable leadership and extraordinary creativity. I will just reference the chant that we sang as we assess, just in case you missed it. Duets that they could sing with their sisters and their friends. Thus began the Frauenchor, they grew in size and rehearsed about once a week. Clara Schumann invited them to perform in a concert with her, which was unprecedented at the time, as women were not allowed to give public performances. They were only performing in the home. Not only was this a significant performance, but it also drew attention to Brahms' compositions specifically for women's choirs, and it inspired his contemporaries to write for women as well. Deborah Spurgeon states in her chapter, perhaps